Good evening, friends. A very warm welcome to Sri All Hands Endowment Lecture Program. Today we have a very distinguished scholar and researcher as the speaker. Sri Sharachchandra Lele will be speaking on Beyond the Planting Trees. Mr. Paul Harris was born in 1868. He was a Chicago lawyer, was the founder of a Rotary, a highly gifted person interested in various subjects. He had his ups and downs in life, but still always he was keen on serving society in some way or the other. He was highly adventurous. He was known for his courage, endurance and keenness to come up in life. And in spite of hardships, he had traveled extensively, and through experience that he gained, insight into people, places and the ways in which men strive to improve their luck. His extensive travel made him a good man of the world. This later resulted in the foundation of Rotary movement. Today, as you are aware, Rotary has been doing wonderful service in virtually almost all the countries of the world. So in his memory, Rotary Club Orchards branch has instituted this memorial program. Sri Sharachchandra Lele, who is also known as Sharad, he got a B.Tech in Electrical Engineering in IIT Bombay in 1984. But then he decided that environmental studies are more exciting and socially relevant. So he did an MS on the environmental impact of large dams at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore in 1987, and then a PhD in Energy and Resources from the University of California, Berkeley in 1993, focusing on forest use in the western Ghats of India. Sharad is an internationally, is an interdisciplinary environmental researcher, bringing the natural sciences, economics, and political science to understand the concepts of and pathways to environmentally sustainable and socially just development. He has worked on sustainable forest management and forest governance, forest hydrology, and farmer linkages, watershed development, water governance, and pollution regulation. He served on the MOEF-MOTA Joint Committee on the Forest Rights Act and the Elephant Task Force appointed by the Karnataka High Court, and is currently on the Belandur Lake Monitoring Committee, the Karnataka Trust Group on Water Policy, and the Central Expert Appraisal Committee for Coal Mining and Thermal Power. Dr. Sharad has edited a volume entitled Democratizing Forest Government in India. It was published by Oxford University Press in 2014. He is Senior Fellow in the Center for Environment and Development, ATREE, Bangalore. ATREE stands for Ashoka Trust for Research in Ecology and the Environment. A very warm welcome to him and a big applause. A very warm welcome on behalf of the people and also on behalf of the donors. A very warm welcome to all of you who are present here to this wonderful program. Over to Dr. Sharad for his enlightening talk this evening.
Thank you, sir, and thank you all of you for braving Bangalore's traffic on a Friday evening to join us here. It's a real privilege to be asked to speak at the Indian Institute of World Culture. As all of us know, it's one of the long-standing institutions in Bangalore devoted to the idea of intellectual discourse amongst peers. And so I hope we will take this occasion also like a, not like a one-way lecture from somebody standing on a stage, but really as a way of starting some kind of a discourse on the question of environmentalism. This idea of speaking on this subject was triggered by some of the events over the last year or so that I'm sure all of you are aware of, and this icon or this figure from a well-known effort to rally millions of Indians to the cause of saving India's rivers, which is a very worthy cause, as all of you would agree, sort of triggered some of this thinking on what we mean by environmentalism and how we go about our environmentalism in today's context. So here it asks us to give us a missed call to save our rivers, which I'm sure all of you on, you know, even a few seconds of thinking would agree that the missed call itself is not going to really save the river. One has to go probably a little bit beyond that. Another slogan of theirs was wear blue on Friday, because that was the day that they were holding the rally for rivers, so everybody was asked to wear blue. And the same kind of symbolism permeates many other aspects of our country's way of approaching environmental problems. So for example, this photograph I took at the Ministry of Environment's building in Delhi. I don't know how many of you can make out this photograph. So this is the main Paryavaran Bhavan, the Ministry of Environment's office in Delhi. And as I entered the building to go to my coal mining and thermal power clearance committee, I saw a whole bunch of school kids in this uniform, you know, chanting some slogans and some, then standing and giving, you know, taking some oaths to keep the environment clean. So I asked the friends in the ministry what was going on. So they said, well, there's been a campaign because of the air pollution that, you know, all of you know, Delhi has been going through a lot of air pollution during the winter. So there's a campaign to clean the air in Delhi. And the students are basically asked to come to Paryavaran Bhavan and take an oath that, you know, somehow they will contribute to keeping Delhi's air clean. The third most common example of our environmentalism, and I say our, it's not theirs, it's our environmentalism, is the idea of planting trees. It permeates all aspects of when we think about saving the planet. We talk about the first thing people mention is plant trees. And it's true in our environment science textbooks, it's true in our, you know, daily sloganeering on the environment, it's true globally also, in the, for example, the Alliance for Focusing on Green. And it's true even in the recommendations that sometimes emanate to say solve all kinds of environmental problems. In this case, I whited out the name of the institute which made this recommendation, that to solve the water crisis in the city of Bangalore, we need to have massive afforestation programs. So I was really struck by this sort of very simplified idea of how we can solve environmental problems. All environmental problems seem to be amenable to one solution, which is planting of trees. Because in fact, if you go back to the first example I gave, which is the rally for rivers, this is what they said in their solution to the problem. So you give a missed call, citizens' voices are presented to the government on 2nd of October, that leads to the adoption of the proposal for river revival, and the proposal's core element is basically planting trees in a 1 kilometer stretch on both sides of all rivers, on government land and private land, fruit trees on private land. And this 1 kilometer wide tree cover stretch, I just zoomed in here a little bit, is going to then revive rivers on the left, and basically that's going to solve our problem. The outcome is going to be river rejuvenation. So that's again, you know, very deeply embedded in our thinking about river problems, that it's planting trees along the banks of rivers that's going to solve the problem of these rivers across the country. Just like planting trees in Bangalore is going to solve, you know, Bangalore's water problem, and so on and so forth. So, you know, frankly, the environmental problems were so simple that we would have probably solved all of them. If you count the number of trees that supposedly have been planted by individuals, by corporations, municipal corporations, and of course by the forest department, we should be drowning, or rather we should be completely surrounded by trees and not have any space to even walk around. Neither has the planting actually been successful, nor have the environmental problems gone away as a result of whatever planting that happened. So what I think that, you know, while we face a lot of challenges from the quote-unquote outside, and what I mean by outside is that if I were to ask in this room, are we environmentalists? I'm sure everybody in this room will agree that at some level they are environmentalists. If we ask us, is Bangalore full of environmentalists, we might get a more mixed answer, that well, there are probably some who are like us and some who are not like us. And then if you extend that question to the rest of the country, are all Indians environmentalists? Again, you're going to get a very, very mixed answer, I'm sure, from this audience. So the question for me was, if we want to go out and proselytize environmentalists in some sense, which I think should happen, we want the rest of the country to become environmentalists, maybe we should reflect a little bit on what we mean by environmentalism ourselves before we go out and do that proselytization. Because maybe the problem of environment, as I tried to give an indication from these images, is a little bit more complicated than planting trees and addressing that problem. And as I propose to you a three-level environmentalism, I'm saying that our environmentalism needs to be deeper, in the sense of it should be science-based, it should be broader, which means needs to have a broader ethical foundation than what we think normally of the need for environmental thinking. And needs to be much more sensitive to process, and that the word I use is more democratic in the way we actually go about our environmentalism, not just in the outside world of the non-environmentalists. So what I'd like to do in the next about 35-40 minutes is make a case or elaborate on these ideas of a broader, deeper and more democratic environmentalism that I put to you that we need to all embrace if you want to actually go out and proselytize something that is going to embrace the complexity or address the complexity of the environmental problem that we face. So let me begin by the idea of a deeper environmentalism, that is an environmentalism which is based on science, and here by science I mean not just science but also social science. You know, conventionally we think of the word science as in the natural sciences, physics, chemistry, biology and so on, and certainly our environmentalism needs to be rooted in a strong understanding of environmental processes. But that needs to be extended to an understanding of the social side of environmental processes also. Why do we have people behaving in certain ways that results in certain kinds of processes being triggered with certain outcomes? So I'm going to give you three examples or three conventional misunderstandings that we have about environmental processes. The first is that trees produce oxygen. So one of the reasons to plant trees, if you ask school kids, the first reason that often comes to the table is, well, trees produce oxygen, and that's why we should be planting trees, because it gives you a cleaner atmosphere. The second myth, as I said, is about trees and hydrology, the role of trees in the water cycle. And hydrology tells us that rivers are not drying because of deforestation or even because of climate change, and that in fact planting more trees will not actually solve the problem of drying rivers. And the third, which is I'm posing to you as a social science problem, is that the reasons why we have the environmental crisis are not simply population growth or ignorance. I mean, it's very easy for us to point to large areas of the environmental problem where we don't know enough, or people don't know enough, people don't understand the problem, that's why they're behaving in certain ways. And of course, population is a well-known kind of rogue in the room, in a sense. There is always the source of most problems. But I'd like to suggest that we need to go into a more sophisticated analysis of why we have these problems. In addition to the fact, of course, that we perhaps don't understand our ecology and hydrology fully. So let me begin with the idea of trees. If you look at the role of trees, basically they photosynthesize. As all plants, they do photosynthesis. And if you have 100 units of photosynthesis happening in a tree, only 50% is actually going into any kind of net production, because the rest of the 50 goes out again as respiration. The tree has to live on a day-to-day basis. So it burns the food that it produces through photosynthesis, it burns it in the 24-hour cycle to actually just do the respiration. And that in that process, about 50%, you know, give or take, goes out from whatever it photosynthesized in the first place. So you're left with the remaining net primary production, which is 50%. And that net primary production during the lifetime of the tree is what is causing the tree to grow. And that includes the growth of the leaves, the branches, and the main stem of the tree. So what actually then happens is that over the next 1 year or so, the leaves are all going to be shed and new leaves are going to come in. So that some of the leaves will fall down and start decaying. Over the next few years, some branches will fall down and start decaying. And over the lifetime of the tree, eventually, the whole stem will fall down and that will start decaying. So what you have at the end of the life of the tree is that all that the NPP it did over its lifetime will then decay, and all the carbon that was fixed in the tree will go back to the atmosphere as carbon dioxide. So the only difference, and that's the number why it says 49 or 50 and not 50 necessarily, is if some of that decayed matter, if some of that biomass, let's say the bole or the leaves or the twigs that fell down, actually get them covered by soil and go deeper into the soil and never actually undergo normal aerobic decay, then it might actually stay in the ground as carbon and not enter the atmosphere back as CO2. So you might have a very small fraction that stays in the ground and enriches the carbon in the ground and really doesn't go back somehow as carbon dioxide. Or it get, you know, falls into a swamp and gets covered by water, and then maybe it undergoes anaerobic decay, and then you have methane getting produced, and it's going back to the atmosphere but in a different form. So really, you could have a very, very small fraction of the entire production that the tree did, the net primary production, maybe staying on the surface of the earth at the end of the cycle. It could also be negative. If, for example, you're burning the forest floor has catches fire, or there are other ways in which you could be disturbing the forest floor and letting out the accumulated soil carbon back into the atmosphere. So you could even have a negative release of carbon dioxide from the soil. So the bottom line here is that even if all the trees on the face of the earth were removed, we would not die of asphyxiation in the first place, because trees were not the source of our oxygen today. We've already reached 21% of oxygen in the atmosphere. And the reason why we have that at 21%, of course, has to do with the historic process over geological time scales in which these photosynthesizing organisms actually disappeared from the carbon cycle and went to the bottom of the ocean. And that's how we have today 21% of oxygen in our atmosphere. But in today's context, you could actually take all the trees on the face of the earth and burn them off and not really affect that 21% with any significant amount at all. Of course, if you remove all the plants from the face of the earth, you may not have food for ourselves, but that's a different problem. It's not the problem of the oxygen being depleted. And we may not want to oversimplify this and say, therefore, trees are useless. Nobody's saying trees are useless. Their role in the carbon cycle is much more important than their role in the oxygen cycle. Why? Because atmospheric carbon dioxide is in very small quantities to begin with. So any changes you make in the carbon cycle have a much bigger impact in terms of the greenhouse gas effect that we are all talking about and climate change that we are all talking about. So this is not to say that trees are useless. It's just to point out that trees are not the producers of oxygen that we all think is the first reason to plant trees. And we may just want to keep that in mind maybe next time we try to convince children to go out and plant trees. The second example I want to give is from the hydrological cycle. And I think it's really important for us to understand this, because all of us are we're not really facing a depletion of oxygen on a day-to-day basis, except if you're standing behind a BMTC bus on the road or something like that. Temporarily, maybe you are depleted of oxygen. But we are really facing a problem of drying rivers. So the Sadhguru's efforts to save the rivers, nobody could question the motivation. We really are faced with the problem of disappearing or drying rivers across the country, whether you are in the Gangetic Plain, certainly if you are in peninsular India. Almost no river is now entering the ocean for other than during some of the flood periods in the year. So we need to understand the hydrological cycle better, and it starts with rainfall, of course, part of which infiltrates into the soil. What doesn't infiltrate runs off on the surface, the surface runoff. What infiltrates, a big fraction of that is captured by the roots in the soil of trees and other vegetation, including agricultural crops, and goes back up to the atmosphere as evapotranspiration. And that really is the biggest fraction of the rainfall. If rainfall is 100 units, about 70% is going back to the atmosphere as evapotranspiration from vegetation, whether it is forested vegetation or agricultural crops that you have replaced the forest with. And only about 5%, 3% or 8% is going down as groundwater recharge. The remaining is going as surface runoff. So 20% or so, 20 to 25% going as surface runoff, and let's say 5% entering further down, passing below the roots and therefore creating what we call as groundwater. So the groundwater table is recharged by this 5%, and the table follows the slope of the land, roughly speaking, and therefore at a point where the table intersects with the river is where the table actually empties into the river, and we get what is called base flow. So if any of us actually go to a river which is not completely dead, let's say the Kaveri a little bit upstream of KRS, or if you go to any of the other bigger rivers, you will see that the river is flowing even several months or throughout the summer period, although for 4 months in a row there is no rainfall. And so we ask the question, how come the river is flowing? Because there hasn't been rainfall for four months, the answer is base flow. It's basically all the water that infiltrated into the Western Ghats or the neighboring hill slopes, and then eventually came out where the groundwater table intersected the river, and that's where you have the post-monsoon flows in the river because of this base flow. So now if you ask the question, what is the role that trees are playing in this water cycle? The biggest role they seem to be playing is actually evapotranspiration. They're taking water out of the water cycle. Of course, at the same time, because of their root systems, they're also enhancing infiltration. So they are playing a very double-edged kind of role. They are sending water out while also enabling some water to go past the root system down into groundwater. And so the question is, what is the net effect of a tree will depend upon what kind of a tree it is, how many trees you have on the landscape, what else it replaces. The net effect is also in comparison to something else. So did it replace grasslands, which actually might have less evapotranspiration, or did it replace sugarcane, which might have more evapotranspiration than your forest, and so on. So it really depends on what else was there before you planted trees, or what were the trees cut down and replaced with. So the net effect will depend upon that, the land use change that you brought about. But they definitely, what it tells us is that all vegetation has this double-edged effect. It transpires water, because that's how vegetation survives, that's how you get that photosynthesis in the earlier slides that we talked about. And at the same time, they facilitate the infiltration of water into the ground. They control soil erosion, and therefore they play an important role in the hydrological cycle. But what therefore this means, on the one hand, is that this double-edged role of trees. On the other hand, if you look at this side of the problem, you can see that presence of groundwater is essential to the flow of rivers beyond the monsoon flows. During the monsoon, surface runoff will enter the river and you'll see the river flowing anyway. But once the rain stops, the only reason that you will see water in the rivers is if you have enough water in groundwater. Which means that groundwater levels, if they drop, then you're going to stop seeing reductions in the base flow of these rivers. So this explains actually three mysteries simultaneously. Why trees might not contribute positively to flows, and therefore why trees might not be the solution to rivers drying. How groundwater consumption leads to the declining flows in the rivers. And this is one thing that we've not really understood. All of our attention, for example, even in the Kaveri dispute, is about who has built which dam on the Kaveri, which is obviously important. You build a big Krishnaratsagar or build a Kabadi dam, you've blocked a certain amount of surface flow, and then you have diverted that flow through irrigation channels into Mandya district or into Bollegaon district for agricultural cultivation. And which means basically you have increased evapotranspiration in the catchment, because now you're giving water to crops which are earlier only dryland crops, which are only using rainwater. Now you're giving them water from the river through these irrigation channels. So these are very visible ways in which we are using more water upstream in Karnataka, and therefore automatically letting less water go down downstream into Tamil Nadu. But what we have not factored in is the invisible ways in which we are doing the same thing, which is that in the catchment of the Kaveri today, we have probably, I don't know, just an estimated number would be 20 lakh borewells, or maybe 50 lakh borewells in the Kaveri catchment. So people are actually pumping groundwater and irrigating their crops. It could be banana, it could be coconut, it could be arecanut, it could be a variety of such crops that are being irrigated. It could be coffee plantations upstream, which are also being irrigated during the summer season and so on. And as a result, you are actually depleting groundwater, therefore depleting the movement of groundwater that would eventually form base flow in the river. And this is most palpable in our very own Tippegodnanalli catchment. If you go to the Tippegodnanalli reservoir and look at the records of PWSSB there, what began in the 1930s as a very important reservoir for feeding water to Bangalore sort of worked in that role for about 40 years till about 1972. And since 1972, you can see a steady decline of inflows into the reservoir, regardless of whether rainfall has been good or bad in a particular year. Normally, it could have tracked the rainfall, but after 1972, you see a decline. After 1992, you see basically no dry season flows, no post-monsoon flows entering the reservoir at all, except this year, which was a really crazy monsoon year. The past 1 year was a really crazy monsoon year, 60% above average, so that's an exception. But otherwise, you just don't see any water entering the reservoir in the dry season, and eventually no water at all. And that has nothing to do with climate change. The record doesn't show any change in the rainfall in the catchment of Tippegodnanalli. It has nothing to do with planting of trees or not. In fact, it has to do the opposite effect, because if you look at what happened in the PGRD catchment, it was a huge expansion in eucalyptus plantations over the last 30-40 years. And eucalyptus is a notorious tree crop in the sense that in that balance between infiltration and evapotranspiration, in the case of eucalyptus, evapotranspiration beats the benefits of infiltration all the time. This is a very fast growing and a very water intensive crop, which roots go down to about 100-120 feet in the soil. So it really seeks out water wherever it can and transpires the water in order to grow really fast. So it's really great for the farmers. They made a lot of money from planting eucalyptus and selling it, but it was therefore a negative impact on the flow of the Arkavati. And finally, it will also explain why many of us are saying that doing watershed development, which has been sort of seen as the mantra for solving all water problems, in the rural countryside, which is that you build check dams and you build various ways in which you increase the infiltration of water into the soil, is not really a solution. All it is doing is repartitioning the water. Instead of the water running off on the surface, now it enters the groundwater. And if your borewells are pumping like crazy anyway, when you just made that water available to the farmer upstream, instead of going down into the irrigation tank downstream from where some other farmer might have used that same water. So you're really just moving water around, you're not creating any new water. So watershed development may reallocate water, and that may be a good thing, depending upon who gets the water, maybe he didn't have water earlier and so on. But it's definitely not creating new water and not solving the problem of river flow decline. In fact, the opposite. Or the irrigation department hates the watershed department people because they are the ones that are creating all these blocks and therefore not allowing the streams to flow as before, and therefore not allowing the irrigation reservoirs to fill as much as they would have in the past, because it's not just the watershed, the structures that are the problem. The structures that are built are accompanied by farmers doing more pumping of that water that goes down up again to grow irrigated crops where they were earlier growing, let us say, ragi or jola or something like that, right? So it's that combination which is really deadly in terms of affecting the flow in the river. So in this context, now we see why this, the simplistic solution of 1 kilometer long wide swaths of tree planting along the banks of a river are really not going to do anything. If not, they might aggravate the problem because they'll suck up whatever little moisture was left in the soil that might have actually ended up in groundwater and eventually in the river. The third level that I'd like to talk about is the point about what causes such environmental problems. And I'm going to take the example of our own Vrishabhavati, on which we worked for several years since 2013. And for those of you who are interested, we have a short 10-minute video on this, which sort of explains the problem in more detail than I'm going to do that, in this short time that I have. But in brief, what I'd like to point out is that when we started this work, we were basically told by the Pollution Control Board that the Vrishabhavati may be polluted by sewage, domestic sewage, because we don't have enough of sewage network, but it certainly doesn't have any industrial pollutants in it. Because the industries in Peenya have all been controlled by the Pollution Control Board, and those heavy metals and all these kinds of things that industries emit have already been brought under control. So my colleague Priyanka, she actually put in a huge amount of work over a 1-year period to monitor the river 24 hours around the clock, once a month for 12 months, where she had staff sitting next to the river and taking samples every hour right through the night. And so then when we plotted the graph of heavy metal concentrations, you can even see in the color of the bottles at the bottom, which match the time at which the sample was taken, the color suddenly starts changing from this sort of normal dark color to a reddish color or a greenish color after about midnight. That's when basically the industries are letting out their pollutants, and when the Pollution Control Board was taking samples at 9 a.m. in the morning on a Monday of a month, obviously they were not finding any heavy metals of significant levels and declaring that the river was clean as far as industrial pollutants were concerned. So this in a sense would reinforce the point that, well, we really don't know enough about the environment, in terms of information, and that's really the reason why we don't have clean rivers. But problem was more complicated than that. When we looked at what the Pollution Control Board was achieving when it found polluters, when it took prosecution cases to the courts, the typical time for these cases to get resolved was 7 years. So they were blaming the judicial system, and not without reason. But you also look at the quality of the prosecution, then you found that by 2016, out of 212 cases that had been disposed, they had lost 134 cases. So 3/4 of the cases they are actually losing in the courts when they take somebody to court at all for for water pollution crimes. If you look at why they are facing this problem, one of the reasons why they can't monitor the rivers and can't actually do effective prosecution, they don't even have enough staff. So 267 is their staff strength, but 100 positions are unfilled for years together. In spite of the fact they have the money to fill those positions. If you look at their finances, they don't seem to have any problem. But the problem seems to be deeper than just the fact that they don't have enough staff. So look at how they are structured, and look at their governing board. There are 17 people on their governing board, and 10 of those are bureaucrats. Two of the bureaucrats actually represent other polluting agencies. So Bangalore Water Supply Board is on the governing board of KSPCB, although KSPC wants to file court cases against BWSSB, but it can't because they have that person on their governing board. The other one is KWSDB, another polluter. Three non-governmental members, the only three members who are nominated by name by the government, are all representatives of industries, agriculture, plantations, and industries. So they are actually representing the potential polluters, not the people who are affected. There's actually nobody who represents the people who are affected by pollution. Absolutely nobody. There's no independent scientific expert. There is no, let's say, elected representative, MLA or corporator or anything of that kind on the pollution control board's governing body. And the way they appoint the chairman and the non-governmental members, completely opaque. So you don't even know why a particular member was chosen as chairman of the pollution control board. On what basis, what expertise, what track record. And they have CEOs which they cannot appoint themselves. The government appoints their CEOs and transfers the CEOs whenever they want. So some forest officer typically sent on deputation for 2-3 years and then disappears. So they have a CEO who's really not accountable to their governing board. But we also have a larger problem, which is that in a country which is pushing forward on the path of industrialization and development that is based on industrialization, how do we reconcile the challenge of pollution with the need to actually have industries? You cannot actually go down the path that we are going without having industries. So there is a larger question for us, which is that in a sense, the PNA industries are creating this pollution because we are the consumers of the products of PNA industrial estate. At some level, you know, our cars have chrome-plated bumpers or chrome-plated taps in our houses or whatever it is. That's really the source of the pollution of chromium in the river of Bangalore or somewhere else. It's the textiles that we use with all the coloring that then has all the dyes that go into the river, Noyal River at Tirupur near Coimbatore. So we are really the final person responsible for that pollution at some level. And the question is, how do we then manage pollution? Because if you had to enforce tighter pollution control, you would have to then pay more for those chromium-plated taps or the particular dyed t-shirts or whatever that we are wearing than we are paying today. So in that sense, our quality of life would go down because more of our income would be spent on these kinds of amenities. So we really need to ask the question, are we willing to pay that higher cost for achieving that level of pollution control or not? And I think that's really at the root of some of these questions that we are facing in our attempt to address environmental issues. My second part is to talk about the ethical basis of environmentalism. And I think for far too long we have been thinking of environmentalism in very simple terms. One way we think about environmentalism is to say, sustainability. We say, Gro Harlem Brundtland, this Prime Minister from Norway, she gave us the concept of intergenerational equity when she wrote Our Common Future, and she said basically we need sustainable development, which means we need to give to our children the same level of well-being that we are enjoying ourselves. We cannot deplete the earth in a way that our future generations would not have access to that kind of well-being. So we need to really ask those questions. Why do we want to save the environment? Is it only because we want to give our future generations the same level of well-being? Is that therefore the only ethical basis, sort of intergenerational equity? Or is there more to our idea of why we want to save the environment? And I would put it to you that actually, if you look at how I myself got into environmental issues, which was I started out as a bird watcher, then went on wildlife trips to various national parks in the country, and really, saw a very positive aspect of our environment and wanted to somehow contribute to sort of keeping that alive. Many of us are drawn to the environment through the positive message of wildlife conservation. One of the first set of environmentalists in our country or elsewhere in the modern era have been people who have tried to save the tiger or tried to save the lion and various such charismatic species, because that's a very positive reason to save the environment. And I think it's important to acknowledge that it's in a sense an enhancement of our own well-being in a non-material sense. Having the tiger out there for us to see is not going to put money in our pockets or not going to make us feel better fed, but it's really a different kind of quality of life that we are talking about when we say that we need nature around us and not just a concrete jungle. And I think that's really important to acknowledge. But the second point, as I said, is where the idea of intergenerational equity or the idea of transferring to the future the same level of well-being and therefore the same level of resources is behind the term sustainability. That you don't want to have future kids not having any water even at 2,000 feet in the ground, then they're not going to have the same level of well-being that we have. So the idea of well-being must last across generations. But really what is often missing in our idea of environmentalism? So sustainable economies, sustainable societies is a very popular terminology that people are using. You know, people are using that in every context that they can think about. Green is another terminology that we use to describe our environmentalism, which could refer more to the quality of life, the idea that we want nature as part of our life. But what we often forget is the third dimension of environmentalism, which is actually really present in our lives, but we sort of shy away from thinking about it, that it is about the well-being of other human beings today, rather than about our future generations. I think this is very critical for us to understand. So the simplest example I can give you is that of, let us say, pollution. If you were to be living on the bank of a river, downstream of a factory which is polluting that river, and you could therefore just go down to Bairamangala Reservoir, off the Mysore Highway, and find a whole bunch of farmers who are farming using this polluted water of the Vrishabhavati. And if you ask them, you know, why is it wrong? What's wrong with that, them receiving polluted water? Or if you ask a person on the street, what is wrong with this industry sending polluted water downstream? Right? Okay, somebody might actually say, well, that polluted water will not have fish, fish will die, and therefore, you know, you're coming back to your conservation argument. But I'm sure most of the people will say it's not fair. It's not fair for one person upstream to affect the life of somebody else downstream, even though the person upstream is, let's say, also making a living. The question is, you're not allowed to, ethically okay for you to pollute somebody else's life when you're making your own living. That's really the fundamental reason to oppose the idea of pollution or the phenomenon of pollution. And I think this is a very simple way for us to understand that many environmental problems are really environmental problems or problems of justice. It's not about future generations. You could keep polluting the river and your industry is never going to suffer because you're upstream and somebody else is downstream. Right? So I can't make the sustainability argument to the factory wala, saying, you know, your future generations are jeopardized if you keep polluting like this. Because the future generations are not dependent upon the river what is going downstream and polluting somebody else's life. So then what justification do I give when I tell the factory person not to let out pollutants into the river? The only justification I can give is that it's not fair to the person downstream. And if the person doesn't buy into the ethical idea of fairness, you're really stuck. If all of us don't buy into the ethical idea that it's also about being fair to others, then we are really stuck. Our environmentalism is going to be very lopsided. It's not going to really meet many of the environmental problems that we are facing today, because that sort of falls outside the pale of our thinking. Somebody might even argue that the conservation ethic is really a justice ethic. It is about justice to other organisms other than human beings. The limitation of that argument is that if you look at conservationists, often they are focusing on charismatic species, tigers, lions and so on. So they are being fair to tigers and lions, but fairness doesn't seem to encompass mosquitoes and, you know, tuberculosis bacteria and so on. So obviously you're not being fair to all organisms. So in my personal opinion, it might be better off to say that, well, that's because we actually find tigers beautiful or lions beautiful or spiritually appealing. We don't find mosquitoes spiritually appealing, and sort of be very open about it, rather than, you know, try to couch the conservation ethic in some kind of a animal rights argument or a deep ecology argument, where you then get caught in this problem of animal rights only seem to extend to some animals but not others. So I just put it out to you. But nevertheless, I think the important thing for us to understand is that there is not one reason to save nature or save the environment. There are multiple reasons, multiple ethical foundations on which environmentalism is built. And an inclusive environmentalism would actually take all of these together. And one of the beauties of Indian environmental movement, at least in the 80s, was that from having started with the Save the Tiger in the 1960s, we started Project Tiger sometime in 1969 when Prince Philip came and gave a big grant to the Indian government. But from being a wildlife-oriented conservation movement, it actually broadened out and actually encompassed this idea, embraced this idea that environmentalism is about everybody's lives, and therefore it is about not imposing unfair costs on somebody when you are doing your own activities. It's about giving equal access to natural resources to all. So it can't be that, you know, I have access to, let's say, electricity that comes from Kaiga nuclear power plant, but the village next to Kaiga nuclear power plant faces the risk of the nuclear disaster but does not get the electricity from that power plant. You know, at least that kind of unfair access to resources should not be happening. And that's true for hydropower plants, it's true for coal mining, it's true for all the resources that we are using in the name of development, but where the allocation of these resources is very lopsided, as it is in the case of forests and water and so on and so forth. So in all of these questions, the question of the equity ethic is as important as sustainability, as important as conservation of let us say, aesthetic parts of nature and so on. And if we embrace this multidimensional idea of environmentalism, then it also leads us to multiple explanations of why we have environmental problems. We are not stuck with only one way of thinking, oh, these guys are short-sighted, they don't care about the future, that's why they behave in unsustainable ways. Yeah, that might actually be true in certain cases where people are being short-sighted. Maybe they don't care about the future, or maybe there's something else going on behind why they are being short-sighted. But there could be other contexts in which it's not about short-sighted and future, it is about your neighbor, it is about not caring about your neighbor, and that's a different kind of phenomenon that we need to explain. And so, one of the things that we also need to embrace, therefore, are multiple explanations, rather than saying there is one reason for all environmental problems, population growth, which was what Paul Ehrlich, one of these famous conservation biologists, you know, wrote the book called Population Bomb, and he basically said all environmental problems are because of population explosions in, of course, these ignorant third world countries such as India and Bangladesh and so on. But there's really multiple explanations for why we have environmental problems, including why we have population growth. And somebody in the economics field might say, well, it's because of imperfect markets, because in essentially the prices of goods, I will give you the example of chrome-plated, you know, water taps or dyed t-shirts from Tirupur, which don't reflect the cost that is being imposed on the environment of producing that particular product. Somebody else might say, well, it's really because the industrialists are all rich and they're able to impose, you know, weak standards or make sure that the KSPCB only sort of takes very, very little action on environmental problems. Because of their economic power, they're able to actually pull it off. And you can see that political economy operating all the time, whether it's access to resources, whether it is not bearing the cost of pollution that you create. You see that kind of the power of the rich operating all the time. Just as you see other kinds of social discrimination, not economics-based, not class-based, but based on caste, based on gender, also operating in the environmental sphere, and therefore women facing the brunt of let's say, deforestation because they have to go longer. So I've been in situations where very well-educated households are willing to adopt efficient chulas to reduce the smoke in the house, but when the women ask for biogas, the husband says, ah, these women are getting lazy, you know. But we don't need to invest all this money in biogas. Efficient chulas is good enough. So the husband is now taking the decision as to, you know, how much work the wife should do in order to put food on the table, in a sense. So all these processes are also operating in our society and creating the environmental impacts that we are talking about. Consumerist values is something that, you know, for example, Mahatma Gandhi had flagged right in the beginning, saying there's enough for everybody's need but not for everybody's greed. And I think that's the fundamental challenge that we have not actually embraced. As we go along this path of, say, post-liberalization, ramping up our consumption levels, everybody is actually targeting the so-called Indian middle class. That's why if you read the papers today, television rights for BCCI have gone at, I don't know how many, 6,000 or 9,000 crores. And you should ask the question for yourself, you know, obviously the money companies that are paying this kind of money, 9,000 crores for televising 100 matches, are not idiots. So they are televising, they're paying that kind of money for some reason. And that money has to be recovered in some form. If the company is not going to go bankrupt after having put out 7,000 crores or 9,000 crores, the money is coming from your and my pockets, basically. Because we'll be then watching all those matches and we'll be given obvious and subliminal messages as to what to buy the next time we go to the supermarket or get onto Amazon. So, clearly it's tweaking our needs, notion of needs, our wants becoming our needs as that process goes along. You could also blame, to a certain extent, the science and technology that we have with us today, because it's been a particular kind of reductionist science which has both the power to give us the mobile phone, but also the inability to see the environmental impacts of the mining that is putting all those precious metals that are needed for making the mobile phone in the first place. We have a huge amount of investment in mobile phone technology, very little investment in looking at the pollution impacts of mining in all these areas, whether it's the Congo or whether it's our own Congo, which is the Jharkhand or Chhattisgarh mines. And finally, as I said, I gave you the example of pollution control boards, but more generally, I think we have a huge problem in the way we govern our society. The way we structure the governance of different agencies, we think we are a democratic society, and and in terms of checking the box, I think we are a democratic society. We are going for elections again in a month's time. To that extent, we are democratic, we vote once in 5 years. But if you look at the structure of our governance system, it's still highly undemocratic. It's still essentially smelling or a vestige of the colonial era. The size of every individual state in India, or most of the bigger states in India, is the size of a nation in Europe. These states are taking decisions without allowing further decentralization of decision making down to the district, taluka and village level. And that's really a source of big concern when it comes to environmental problems, because you can then sit in Bangalore and decide this water from Yathinole, the West Bank Netravati River, will now be brought to Bangalore because Bangalore needs a paramount and fishermen in the Netravati estuary really don't matter. You can move the same kind of water from the Sharavati to Bangalore, again saying Bangalore needs a paramount, and so on and so forth, because you really have given them no voice in having the same those decisions about whether or not water can be moved, because we don't have a concept of decentralized water rights. We don't have a concept of decentralized forest rights. So you can allocate sites for mining and declare that these communities need to move because the coal under the forest is more precious or more valuable to society than the forest to those particular communities. So I think that's my final point, which is that we really need to democratize our environmentalism, and we need to embrace that in the environmental community itself, because very often we are so focused on the outcome, a clean environment or a beautiful lake or whatever it is, that we skip the process through which we arrive at that outcome. The process through which we actually decide that this is the way the lake should be. And we see that challenge and that tussle happening in Bangalore on a day-to-day basis. We have a certain set of friends of lakes groups which are really putting a lot of effort in rejuvenating lakes, but not necessarily asking questions like, well, whose water is this anyway? Whose wastewater, if the lake is filled with sewage, well, whose wastewater is this anyway? And to what extent does Bangalore have rights on that water, given that that's all Kaveri water coming up 100 kilometers from the Kaveri and then going down our toilets and entering these lakes? Because the government has suddenly decided that that wastewater really should be sent to Kola for rejuvenating the groundwater there, which the farmers had depleted by pumping. Now they are saying this water is really Kaveri water, it belongs to the state of Karnataka, and once you have used it in your toilets, we will take it down the stream, treat it somewhere and send it to Kolar. And who are you to come in the way and say it has to sit in my lake and evaporate? Because essentially that's the thing that you will actually do. When you put it in the lake, you are evaporating a huge amount of water in the name of environmental amenities. And we need to recognize that. We can't dodge the question that, is lake use sort of so-called green and all of the use is non-green? Because lake use is my use of the lake, whereas somebody else wants to put that water for irrigation and so on. So we really need to confront that, and that confrontation of the complexity of that environmental problem, where lakes take wastewater, store it, evaporate it, some of it goes into the groundwater, some of it goes downstream to the next lake, or might go down and get picked up by a farmer. Now if you start doing more recycling in Bangalore, there is less water going down to the farmer in Vairamangala or somewhere else. So the whole complexity of that problem only comes to the fore when we have a democratic process through which these issues are tackled. Not if one bureaucrat is going to sit in Vidhan Sabha and take some decisions about water to be moved from here to there, or at the behest of the chief minister or a particular minister. So I think that process of decision making itself needs to become much more transparent and accountable, so that the outcomes that emerge are emerging through some kind of acceptable process. They will have a greater likelihood of being sustained over time, rather than if we have top-down outcomes, even green outcomes, imposed, whether it is 1 kilometer wide, tree belts or whatever it is that you impose on the farmers, that's never really going to take root. I mean, they are not going to allow you to do that on their farms anyway. So there's going to be a lot of conflict around environment issues as we go forward. And unless we embrace the idea that we don't know, even as an expert, so-called environmental expert, as per the introduction given to me, I cannot claim to know the right solution for every environmental problem. I think we need to say that we need to bring the best knowledge to the decision making, but the decision making has to happen in the public domain. And it has to involve the multiple affected parties. And that understanding that there are multiple affected parties, that environmental problems are not a simple thing of environmentalists are good and those who are against them are bad, is not that kind of a simple logic that prevails. I think is really important for us. And water is a classic example where there are multiple users for water, and no user can claim to be the right user of water. Whether it's a domestic, whether it's industry, whether it's agriculture and so on, everybody has a legitimate needs, everybody is contributing to the problem in some sense, and therefore there is no divine right that I have to water from the Kaveri or from the Netravati or from the Sharavati at the expense of somebody else. And I think that understanding that really the environment is a very complicated phenomenon, and every action that I take has consequences for somebody else, now or in future generations, or for the non-human organisms is really something that we need to embrace much more in the way we go about. I'd like to end by giving the example of forests, just because I've been looking at the draft national forest policy that the current government has put out for public comment last week ago. Forests are really a classic example of this, you know, every action having implications for others. So we think of forests as this wonderful thing which produces firewood for the local community, which produces timber for the regional economy, which produces, you know, does soil conservation and prevents soil going downstream into the Gangetic Basin or the Kaveri Basin, and they store carbon at the same time, and they have their habitats for biodiversity, whether it's elephants or tigers or leopards and so on. So we think of forests as this wonderful thing, and therefore constantly think of setting higher and higher targets for forest conservation. We always talk about 1/3 of the country needs to be under forest cover, 2/3 of mountainous areas need to be under forest cover, and so on. And the new draft has also reiterated the same idea. But what we forget is that precisely because forests produce these different things, the ecology also tells us that they don't produce all those things simultaneously to the maximum extent. If you want to conserve biodiversity at the maximum level, then you would not want to plant, let's say, tea plantations, you know, just one species of a tree all along that forest, or eucalyptus, or acacia, or pine, which are the kinds of species that we have introduced into these forests because we wanted something else at a higher level. We wanted the timber, or we wanted the pine resin, or we wanted the softwood from eucalyptus for our paper mills. Those were our goals. And so to enhance the production of those objectives, we let go of some of the other things like biodiversity, or firewood, or grazing material for animals, and so on. And this trade-off is always going to be there. There's no one good forest. So then the question in the forest sector, as much as in the water sector, is who decides how to use the forest for which purpose? Should you just plant a whole bunch of trees because now the Indian government has made these commitments in Paris that they will sequester 3 billion tons of CO2 equivalent by 2030 in the forest sector? So then the Indian government is now going, you know, sort of at full speed saying that commitment has to be met, so everything else in a sense falls by the wayside and forests are meant to sequester carbon. And the fastest way to sequester carbon is to plant eucalyptus. That's the fastest growing tree species available, and animals don't eat eucalyptus, so you don't have to worry about even protecting that plant very much. It just grows like crazy and you've sequestered a whole bunch of carbon. And that the new forest policy actually says that we need to go for carbon positive timber forestry as the main objective of forest policy now, which is a complete U-turn from 1988. But if we recognize that there are these multiple objectives and they can't be maximized all at the same time, the question of then who decides becomes very central, which means it's a question of governance. How do we take these decisions about, you know, which forest is meant for what purpose? Maybe there's a place for plantations on the landscape, but maybe it's not the whole landscape. And maybe it shouldn't be the landscape which has been used by people traditionally for grazing. Maybe it has to be somewhere else. Maybe it shouldn't be in the most sensitive slopes of the catchment of a river. So who takes those decisions? And right now our decision making is all centralized. It's essentially done by the forest department sitting in Bangalore, which is again a vestige of the colonial period where the British colonizers took over our forests for their own purposes. And we haven't shed those vestiges. We are still very much stuck in that anti-democratic way of taking decisions, even though we have laws which now ask that communities be given those rights to manage forests at the local level. And the forest department is one of the biggest opponents of implementing that national law. And therefore we have a stage where we are not able to think about forests also as being managed in a decentralized manner, and decisions being then influenced by, let us say, some economic incentives or disincentives that the government might give for, let's say, increasing biodiversity or increasing carbon or something like that, without really forcing particular decisions down the throats of individual communities. And so we have this constant tussle, you know, conservationists want to just have wildlife, foresters want timber, as I said, the government wants carbon, and the communities are also looking for income while simultaneously meeting their subsistence requirements. Farmers say, let's just do soil conservation, nothing else. In the absence of a win-win-win, we have to focus on this question of democratic decision making. And I think we haven't paid enough attention to this. The latest forest policy draft makes a mockery of whatever little steps were taken earlier to democratize that decision making process. It really doesn't focus on that question at all. And unless we see the links between democratic decision making in the sense of decentralized governance down to the grassroots, and the grassroots need not be only these, you know, what shall I say, romanticized villages. That's, one doesn't have to romanticize the village in order to say that they have a right to take decisions about their environment, just as we don't have to romanticize ourselves in order to say that, well, if a Bangalore is a city of 1 crore people, it has 200 wards, that's 50,000 people in a ward on an average, and who's taking decisions about the wards and through what process? You and I, you know, one of the 50,000 in each in those wards doesn't really even know what's going on in terms of decisions being taken in that ward for even simple things like roads and street lights, let alone more complicated things like water and electricity and so on. So I think the need for democratic decentralization is to across the board, the rural as well as the urban. The urban people like us have a little bit more of a voice, maybe through the fact that we are more educated and maybe have more cell phones per head or something. But really, that the question of not having the same decision making applies across the board. And I think that is something that we all need to tackle as a part of our search for an environmentally friendly way forward. So I'd just like to summarize by saying that we live in an era where forces against environmental thinking and environmentally positive action are very, very strong and increasing. So someone might say actually that, why look inwards and get into all these complexities of environment? Aren't you creating more problems for environmentalists because you're really splitting them into all these different groups, the justice wallahs, the sustainability wallahs, the conservationists and so on. But actually I would say that the lack of introspection within the environmental community, and I include all of you in that, because we need not be people who go on morchas for environment in order to be environmentalists. The lack of introspection allows others to selectively use the babas and the carbon sequestration arguments to put out greenwash documents, to put out greenwash policies, to implement greenwash programs, in the name of environment, and start looking pro-environment when they are really not at all. And I think unless we have embraced that complexity, we have moved towards a broader understanding of environmental concerns in an ethical sense and a deeper one in the science sense, I think when we move in that direction, we will have actually strengthened the environmental movement, strengthened environmental thinking, and I think confronted the real challenge, which is ourselves. I mean, we cannot dodge the fact that here sitting in Bangalore, we in the room are as much part of the problem as hopefully we'll become part of the solution going forward. Thank you.
We can have some three questions, please. Yes, sir. Please come forward. Please, can you use the mic, sir?
You can just say it for me, sir. You were telling about democracy many times in the lectures. I just want to know, sir, whether whenever we are speaking of democracy, I want to just name three countries which are having different structures of governance. One is America with a lot of resources and a very good democracy, at least superficially. And ours is a country without much resources. We are having a lot of other problems also. And then China, which is an authoritarian regime. And I think probably more control can be we can have on the environment. Out of these three countries, what is the approach they are taking? Whether whose approach is better as far as environmental control is concerned?
Good question.
I think it's a very fair question, all of us, and that is exactly the point I was making about outcomes versus process. The point that I was making about outcome versus process, the comparison between India and China is a really apt comparison to illustrate that point. We see that shift in China now, having plundered their resources and having become the production powerhouse of the world. Now they have also taken on the environmental message, and they are going equally berserk in the name of environment. So they are pushing people off the farmlands in order to plant trees in the catchment of the Three Gorges Dam. Having constructed the dam and destroyed a whole bunch of livelihoods, now a whole new bunch of livelihoods have been destroyed because people are being moved off farms and made to plant trees and stop farming, right? So I think this is a very fundamental question for us, that do we embrace an non-democratic process because we believe the outcome is a superior outcome? And I guess at some level that's also an ethical choice that we make, that but I would also add to it the uncertainty around environmental problems and the complexity around environmental problems, the multiple stakes that are involved in the environment,
You know, the forest dweller is trying to get some firewood from the forest. Somebody else is saying the forest should be saved for the carbon. Somebody else is saying the forest is a source, you know, a place for wildlife, and so on. Nobody is wrong. Then the reconciliation cannot be done by a technocrat or a manager or a bureaucrat sitting in Beijing or in Delhi. And I think this fundamental understanding that a long-term impact which is not to be suicidal for some people. I think the problem what we forget is that when we say we are saving the environment, but how can we have saved the environment if people have died or if people have been displaced? That's not, to my mind, a really... You can have a very green, you know, catchment with no people in it because all the people have been kicked out. Now, is that what is our understanding? So it goes back to what is our understanding of a good environment. Does a good environment mean a people-less environment? This is the American definition of a good environment. For the Americans, once having decimated the Native American population, you have a very large land area for a relatively small population, 30 crores in a country which is three times the size of India. So now you can visualize a pristine environment out there in the Yellowstone National Park or in Grand Canyon National Park or wherever, to be enjoyed by a set of urban dwellers who live in New York or San Francisco or Philadelphia or whatever. But we forget that in the only way they can enjoy that national park, that pristine national park that they have supposedly kept pristine, is A, by having decimated the population that lived there to begin with, but B, by then having a very high carbon lifestyle which enables them to go from New York to Yellowstone or from New York to Grand Canyon or wherever to have that enjoyment. So you really cannot visualize a lived environment without asking who is the person living and what is their lifestyle, what is their carbon footprint or resource footprint, water footprint, you know, all those resources that they need to live. So what we do is, in this conservation context, is we separate those two and say, I need a pristine environment out there, but not asking the question who I am and what am I doing to the environment in the process of creating supposedly these pristine pockets. So I think both examples point to the limitations of either a conservation-oriented environmentalism that forgets that environmentalism is also about how we live and what impact we have on the rest of the world, which is the US, or the Chinese example where you suddenly now say that environment, you know, green cover is part of the national goals and impose it in a completely undemocratic manner, and the cost that it imposes on livelihoods are just unbelievable and not calculated because you're not even allowed to calculate them in China.
Yeah, please come here. Yes,
sir. Can we be optimistic with what you have said? You know, there's so much lot to do with Murli, and there's a lot to do with education, and we see with the way education is and people not knowing, and there's so much needed to be understood from what you said. It's highly intellectual and not many can understand because of the level of education. So what is the level of, I mean, can we be optimistic with this kind of, you know, we need to educate people about democratic processes, and can we really be optimistic, or my question is about, are you optimistic about the way things are going? And
if I wasn't, I wouldn't be here, right? No, I think we cannot afford to not be optimistic. That's one answer to you, because in a sense, that's then we are doomed to fail. But I think more importantly, I don't think we should over, by trying to bring the complexity to the fore, I'm actually trying to talk to people who have come from an educated background and thought they have understood the problem, but in a sense oversimplified it, right? Our challenge is that it's true, for example, if you go to a farmer, he may not know the connection between his borewell pumping and somebody else's borewell being affected and so on. In a very minute sense, he may not know that. But when we did our discussions with farmers in the Arkavati catchment, the initial response for why the Arkavati is drying was, Sir, Malayala Kamiyaito, Yen Madodo. You know, it's the rain decline which is the cause of the Arkavati, not flood. It's a standard response. Then you show them the graph of rainfall of the last 60 years, the fact that it is going up and down, but the average is remaining flat. And you say this, then the second response, Sir, idu Nelamangala station tosta irudu, now it's up a bere kade idivi, you know, it's not our rain you're showing. Then you show them the second station, which is closer to their village, the third station, which is, you know, in the same area and so on. And on an average, the graph is still going horizontally. So then finally, someone fellow will say, Yenappa, neenu nan gottu, you know, the borewells that we have all dug in the last 30, 40 years, that's the reason for this, what is going to happen to the river at the end of the day. So once you sort of corner them with some basic facts and figures, they are also forced to accept, it's in a way a human psychology not to accept blame in the beginning. It is not necessarily lack of knowledge. They may not have the numbers, they may not have the hydrogeologist stamp, and in fact the hydrogeologists are doing us a disservice by going off on their wrong science. They're not making the link between groundwater depletion and river flow declines. So we need to improve that science and then communicate better with the farmers. I think that's really the challenge. It's not really that you have to give, you know, make the issue so complicated the farmer doesn't understand. Intuitively, I think if you explain, people will accept. The question is, what do they do after they accept? Yeah, they accept that, you know, they're engaged in competitively going down, you know, deeper and deeper. And then at some point, they might get become agreeable to a collective limitation of how much water is to be used. And you see small pockets of that happening across the country. The farmers have come together and put limits on each other as to how much pumping you should do, because we are all in the same boat. We will all suffer if the groundwater goes to 2,000 feet, and we should be, you know, allow each other to do that. If there is certain collective understanding, people are willing to then enforce it. So we come to the institutional side of the story, right? So the government has kind of given up the, on that completely, saying free electricity to farmers, that's all we should be doing. We should not be talking about limiting groundwater withdrawals. So we need to restart those conversations. And I think there is hope there.
I'm Narayan Prasad. Two of the major problems that Bangalorians face are waste disposal and air pollution. I think typical of any big, large urban city. So how do you think these two can be addressed?
So I think both problems point to the challenge between where do we place the blame, right? At some level, we can always put the blame for solid waste on ourselves, saying we are the ones who are buying these packaged products and then throwing the plastic in the dustbin, and it eventually ends up in, you know, in some stream or something of that sort. But if you ask the larger question, you know, why is it that we are trapped in a certain lifestyle where we are using these products in a particular way which has so much packaging? Clearly, we are enticed by the ease, by, you know, clicking on my app in my cell phone on Amazon, I'm able to get this product home in the next 3 days, and forgetting about the amount of packaging that is involved in that courier bringing me that small little thing that I bought on Amazon, you know, the extra packaging that came with that. There is clearly a larger structural problem in the way we have set up our economy to use solid, you know, to use products and generate solid waste. And one way of addressing that could be through taxation policies, which would really heavily tax people on the amount of solid waste they generate at the production stage or at the shipping stage or the distribution stage and so on, rather than only targeting. Today what we are doing is we are doing end of the pipe solutions. We are saying households must then segregate, they must do this, they must do that, and then of course the tempo wala comes and puts all in the same tempo, and, you know, because there's no way we can, in a city of 1 crore people, to visualize the idea of managing the garbage collection system at a city level rather than at a decentralized ward level, you know, where you, if you were given resources at the ward level to actually control the whole system at the ward level, that might actually improve that system. So it ties into various things. It ties into the structure of the economy as well as structure of governance in terms of both the source and the side, the pollution effects of solid waste. I think the air pollution problem is somewhat similar. Again, you know, how much is my driving a result of my wanting to drive? How much of it is a result of the absence of public transport or the, let's say, limited quality of public transport that is available? If I had taken public transport to come here today, which I was trying with the idea because the metro station is not too far away, but it would have cost me another 45 minutes or so extra to come all the way via from Bangalore, from Kengeri to some metro station which is 9 kilometers away anyway. So I think clearly we are struggling with creating public investments which address needs that will enable us to give up, you know, not go down the path of individual satisfaction of the needs, which is much more resource intensive, right? And transport is a very good example of that. And goes back to a question of how are we governed? Who is making the decisions about public versus private, you know, roads versus metro, or public transport versus private transport? Sunita Narayan had a very nice analysis of taxation policies for vehicles. They showed that, Center for Science and Environment in Delhi, they showed that the per passenger kilometer tax that is paid by public vehicles in Delhi, public buses, is 3 to 4 times more than the per passenger kilometer tax that private cars are paying. Right? So it's just amazing how we have structured our taxation system. Oh, these are commercial operators. You know, in Delhi, you know, it's private buses that operate on these public transport routes. So these are commercial vehicles, so they are taxed at a very high rate. So even though they are carrying 50 passengers, they are actually paying more per passenger kilometer than your individual cars. It's an amazing analysis. It just shows how our governance system has a long way to go before it's factoring in these issues.
Only one question.
We'll take it offline. Friends, when we started eagerly listening to the learned research scholar, probably we were much clearer what environmentalism is and what democratization of decision making is. Sir, true to your reputation, you have thrown quite a few questions which definitely will make us think a lot after the lecture. That in fact is what a good speaker should do. It was really amazing the way you brought in quite a lot of facts to make us think and cogitate on these issues in the context of the perplexing theories that have been floated about the role and responsibility of the citizens in ensuring a better and a safer environment. There was a small book way back in 1971 by Shoemaker, Small is Beautiful, in which he comes out with a number of indigenous systems of saving the environment, where particularly in the context of ancient India, the environment was so nicely protected because nothing was destroyed. And there was such a beautiful coexistence between the people who lived in that environment and the environment itself. Sir, I think you have really given a lot of issues for us to think about, and it was really very well placed program. On behalf of the members who are present here, on behalf of the donors, and also on behalf of the Indian Institute of World Culture, we are very thankful to you for this wonderful, highly thought-provoking talk. Should you continue to come to this Institute of World Culture and make us think with larger audiences, and it was really a very wonderful evening for all of us. I also thank the donors for this program, the Rotary Club of Palasar Church, and also all of you who have come here for this program. This weekend we have a series of food programs. Sri T.K. Jayaraman will be speaking tomorrow on French Enlightenment by Voltaire. He'll be speaking about Voltaire and his thought processes. Day after tomorrow morning, we have a talk, that is on Sunday morning at 10:30. We have a program by Shatavadani Dr. R. Ganesh, Samskrita Sahityadali Bharatiya Samaja. This will be the sixth in the series on the same topic. And on Sunday night, we have a Hindustani classical recital by Pandit Shri Ganapati Bhatt Hasanagi, one of the most renowned Hindustani exponents. I request all of you to be present for these programs also.